Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Hallelujah. How are you today? Let's stand together. Let's welcome everybody, our friends, our family, our visitors. If you're first time, second time, you're welcome here. Thank you for choosing this church to worship God with us. Amen. I love the Lord when He said to His words, let us enter His gates with thanksgiving in our hearts. Let's take this opportunity to praise Him. I know God saw you took time coming here. We are so busy doing some business, anything, but God see you took time to get here.
Yes.
Thank you, Father God. We bless you today. We have gathered here for one purpose, to give you praise, to thank you, to worship your name, Jesus.
Yes.
Hallelujah, Jesus. We want to worship you with one spirit and through it. We ask the Holy Spirit to guide us in everything we do today. Father God, open our hearts, open our life so we can receive you today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Let's clap our hands.
Jesus, enemies
your name, in Jesus, oh God. Yes. Everything will come down, oh God. Yes. Our troubles, our problems, oh God.
Hallelujah, Lord God. We praise you this morning.
Yeah.
is beautiful, Lord. Yes, God.
Thank you.
In our mind, Lord God. We want more of you, Lord God. We want to know you more and get deeper in our relationship to you, Lord God. Yes, God, we thank you, Lord God, for your love, Lord God, that your love never fails us, Lord God. Your amazing love, Lord God, and your grace is sufficient for us, Lord God. Thank you, Jesus. And let's sing it one more time. Heal my heart.
Hi, Grace. How you doing? Limuela get back okay? Last week, Limuela was here, and I missed seeing her coming in, so she would have been up here to say hello to everybody because she's been away for 4 months in Scotland, I think. That's where she went, right, Scotland? Yeah. Anyway, she came up to me when the service was over and said hello, so that was good. Children's ministry is about to start. There was a cell phone out in the lobby there. Looks like it might work if anybody needs one. If you're missing your cell phone, that might be it. So the kids want to come up? Or the children? There we are. The little fellow's looking up here and he's saying, he's not Amy.
Yeah. He doesn't even look like Amy.
What's going on here? Amen. What a wonderful bunch of children. The new, the upcoming prophets and evangelists for the world, right here for us. Amen. Just stretch your hands towards them. Father, I thank you today for the beginning of life can be the beginning, God, where you plant seeds in their life that will grow and mature and bring much fruit. Lord, I thank you for this group of young people, this generation, God, that you're raising up to touch this world. May today be a day of special anointing upon them, special blessing, in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. There you go. Just walk by grace. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I've asked Adam to share a testimony with us this morning. So, in fact, I've asked him a while back, and we're just getting around to it. So he should be well prepared. I also mentioned that the church envelopes are at the back for those that need them. I know that most people give direct online now, but we do have envelopes, and there were some calendars there at the back too. So Adam is a great man of God, someone who is in past situations where we've had discussions, and I would always say when it seemed like, well, you know, like, what are we going to do about this? And his answer would always be, we just need to get closer to Jesus. And so I always appreciated that, because that's the answer I needed to hear.
Well, thanks a lot. I'm actually, because you asked me so long ago, I forgot about it, so I'm actually not prepared at all.
There you go.
No, thanks. Nice to see this side. I never really see this side of the church.
He's always over there.
Over there, controlling kids, so... nice to see everyone. Thanks for having me. As Pastor said, he wanted me to share my testimony this morning. So just a quick background about me. I grew up here in the area. When I was younger, my parents were also here. We went to church when we were younger, kind of drifted away from it as I grew older. Really what happened was sports and partying became the idols of my life growing up here in Cape Breton, and we kind of stopped going to church when I was around 10. Don't remember the exact age, but turned into more so one of the kids that would tell them I'm going to church and then skip over to my friend's house, and then tell them I was there. So grew up really heavily involved in sports, nothing to do with Christ, church. Kind of more so made fun of a couple believers that I played hockey with and things like that, who did follow Christ. And so left high school while I was going to university, joined the Army, ended up deploying to Afghanistan with the infantry in 2007 as a machine gunner. Spent about 7 years in the Canadian Army. Interesting enough, when we were going to Afghanistan, we stopped in Dubai to get used to the climate and gather our weapons and things like that. And we were all given Bibles, so I started reading the Bible. I was like, "Oh, it's not a bad thing to read while we get used to going over there." So I just started reading it. I remember literally five times in a row for about 3 days straight, I'd read something about Christ, I'd close the Bible, and have incredibly terrible nightmares. It was real. Like it was. I remember. It was like demons just chasing me and hunting me down, like for about five times in a row. And I remember slamming the Bible shut over there in Dubai, and I was like, I'm never reading this again. So sure enough, came back when I was over there when I was 20. Came back around 21. When I was 20, just turned 24. A friend of mine. Who I grew up playing sports with was a believer, actually died in a tragic motorcycle accident. Through that, I remember going to the wake and the funeral and seeing that although it was such a tragedy and devastation, the hope and the faith and the presence of what I didn't know at the time was the Holy Spirit through the wake and through the funeral was so tangible, it kind of got me questioning things that I could see his parents, and though everything, though they were going through and it's a really the toughest time, there was just a tangible hope and peace that really got my head turning through that. And I remember after the funeral going up to the other believer that I used to make fun of, that I was still friends with, that we played hockey with growing up, and I said, I want to ask you about this. I remember I was very intoxicated at the time. I still went up to him. I said, I want to ask you about this God stuff. I have a lot of questions for you. And he found it very weird coming from me because of my lifestyle, and we grew up together. So anyways, sure enough, a couple days later, I messaged him, met up for coffee, and I grilled him for about 2 hours straight, because I wanted to know. I was like, what's about this Christ? Why do you do this? Why don't you go to this other churches or denominations? What's the difference? Anyway, sure enough, which was very interesting, at the end of that conversation, I said, you know, I could feel the conviction that I wanted to give my heart to Christ. Which is amazing, because I did not attend church at the time, did not read scripture at the time. However, Christ is so relational and alive, he draws people to himself by means of his own family, the church. So our church is not in here. It is. There's a church in here, but if all that you're doing is in here, then we're failing, because we, the church, is the body of Christ, who is out to make disciples and to call people to Christ himself. So that was amazing. He gave my heart to Christ. Had no idea really what I did at the time. At the time I just turned 24, I bought my first house. Still living my very crazy lifestyle. And all of a sudden I remember I started getting convicted of that lifestyle. And nobody told me anything. Nobody was saying, you got to stop this, you got to do this, do, don't. I just started getting convicted. And I remember going back up to him and being like, I feel like, he never said anything to me. And I said, I feel like I shouldn't be doing these things. Like, I feel like really I don't want to. Not that I shouldn't do it, follow a set of rules. I just don't want to anymore. And he started chuckling. He's like, well, that's the Holy Spirit. And then explained what your new life in Christ really means. And then through that, he said, you need to start reading you're a new Christian, you need to start reading the Bible. You need to get into the Word of God to see what this faith and who this Christ is that you have accepted. So through that, I remember the first year, the weekends went from out all night, every night, doing everything to, you know, starting to study the Word and really, like, hunger and thirst for it and really dive into it. And then that... and then actually it was his mother that said, you know, you also need to be discipled, because you need someone to explain this to you. And then we started coming to this church. I started coming, I think, on my own, 2010, I believe it was, and then started doing Bible studies. And it was just me going to the Bible study, which was kind of funny. So I just started learning more and more. Then I was blessed enough to meet my amazing wife here, who wasn't a believer and at the time. And I remember our second date, we were having lots of conversations, because I was very open. I was also very new. And her question to me was, so how do you believe that you get to heaven? And I kind of explained salvation through Christ. And she responded with, so you're telling me right now, if I die and don't know Christ, then I'm going to be separated from God eternally. And I said, yes, that's what I'm saying. And I was like, I remember thinking, I was like, well, that was a fun two dates. That's the end of it. God had other plans, really nothing to do with myself, but the Spirit leading her to himself. And I think 2 weeks later, she accepted Christ. We were married less than a year after that. Both my parents, who weren't following, also accepted, like I think the week after she did. And then it kind of went from there. Her sister Giselle's here, had probably one of my favorite stories of when she accepted Christ. Don't have time for it, but it was just, it's a really cool story. And I know Monique's dad's back here too. So really cool how it all happened. I was very new at the time as well. And then everything, we lived happily ever after. No, just kidding. Obviously that's not the way life goes. And that's not the way the Bible paints a picture of the Christian life either. So we were married. We've been married for just over 11 years now. Our first 5 years of marriage, we were trying to build a family. We had 6 miscarriages in 5 years. Through that, God did an amazing work in our own hearts. drawed us closer together through that. And I don't know if you're around when we had our first baby dedication at Sherwood Park about 5 or 6 years ago. Monique gave an awesome testimony about how she wouldn't change any of that because of the good things that God did through that tragedy, through those losses. And through that, we were able to adopt two boys, our oldest two. We adopted them, they're full brothers. We adopted them when they were little babies. And then about a few years after that, I remember one day we were home and, you know, you just, sometimes you just feel the spirit to go, need to go pray. And so I felt the Holy Spirit tell me when we were reading the word to go pray over Monique and that she'd be healed. And I was like, yeah, I'm not doing that. Because it was almost like at this point, it was like 8 or 10 years. And I'm just like, I don't, and we didn't even know if we wanted any more kids. We just adopted two boys in like 2 years. So sure enough, I just couldn't shake the feeling. So we went down and we prayed together. And she looked at me. She's like, what was that? I was like, I don't know. I don't even know what it means, but I just felt the need to pray over you. I think 2 months later, she was pregnant. And then we had our third baby. So it's really... really cool story. I often use the proverb that man orders his plans, but it's God who really directs his steps. And we're just thankful to him for his faithfulness. We don't know what it's always going to look like, or how tough. Well, it's always going to be tough, but we're just thankful to him, and we're just thankful, and just wanted to encourage everyone as well. I'm leading a Bible study on Mondays now on God's providence, and two things that stand out in Scripture when you choose to follow Christ. He creates in his own people. He creates people and saves people so that they'd center everything that they have and everything who they are on Christ himself is the one, first thing. Second thing is that those people enjoy being transformed into the image of Christ. So Hebrews, I think it's 10:14, says he forever by that one sacrifice to Jesus made perfect those who are being made holy. So if you're in Christ, you're perfect because God looks down and sees Jesus, not yourself, but you're also being conformed into his image and being sanctified through that. And that will be a work until we go home to glory. So just be encouraged and hungry for the Lord. And yeah, thanks for letting me share my testimony.
Thanks, Adam. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. Great to hear that testimony. I thought of that song, He Keeps On Blessing and Blessing. He keeps on pouring it on. His love gets richer and richer. And I keep giving him my song. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. How's everybody doing? Everybody have a good new year so far? Amen. Good to see you in church, the first Sunday of the new year. Yeah. I hope that's more than a New Year's resolution. Yeah, because we all break those. Somebody said to me, did you have any New Year's resolutions? I said, I stopped doing that years ago. Hallelujah. One couple in the church, New Year's Day, their sewer backed up, and... water come up and went on the modem for the computer and wiped that out. And I said, Happy New Year. It seems that problems don't give us a break. Hallelujah. Maybe I'm talking to the wrong crowd this morning, but problems, what I thought about it, I said, well, they started off, the school of stress started earlier this year than usual for a lot of people. And I found that there's always a tuition to pay for any institution of learning. You can't get in the institution unless you're willing to pay the price. And how many know the Holy Spirit is our professor? And the school that we're in is the school of the Holy Spirit. And sometimes we'll say, Lord, I'll praise you no matter what. We can say that. No, I'll praise you no matter what. And then what happens? And sometimes the school is there, the professor's there, the Holy Spirit's there, and we're saying, well, Lord, even in hard times, I'll praise you, or I'll rejoice in hard times. Well, the tuition then is going through a hard time to see if you get a diploma. that says, I will praise him in hard times. Amen. Because without the test in school, no one knows whether you're graded or not. And so the tuition in God, no matter what we're asking God for, there is a tuition we pay to get the diploma in the school of hard knocks. Amen. And the things that we go through. There's a scripture found in Romans 12 and 2 that we kind of, most people would know it as a familiar verse of scripture. It just says, do not be conformed to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind in 2024. It says, then you. Now, do not be conformed to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then. Just a second in. I don't know if you got it yet. I didn't hear any amens yet. Do not be conformed to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then. Then is like a therefore. If you don't do the renewal, you don't get to the then. So then, if you have not conformed to this world and you have renewed your mind, then you will be able to test and prove what is the what's God's will is his good, pleasing, and perfect will. And so it seems like we want to avoid any test, but we would like the diploma. We would like to pass the grade without making the grade, without attending the class. Sometimes in school, people will miss all their classes and show up on grading day and say, where's my diploma? And so we're in the school of faith in God, and you're all here today. This is a new year. We're hoping for better things. And I put a title on this morning, Increase Hinges on Certain Things. An increase in 2024 will hinge on the decisions you make. It's on certain things that you certainly need to decide. I said in the prayer room earlier, I said the scripture that came to my mind was, he will keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. He will keep. That's not my question. My question is, will I keep what I've committed to him? Because sometimes we make big promises. We have big deal. We say, God, I'll do this and I'll do that. God, I'll be faithful here and I'll be faithful here. But then the tuition that we have to pay for our own words is that we have to learn to conform not to the pattern of this world. What's that look like? The Bible would, and the other thing is that the Bible would not tell us to not conform unless it was possible to conform. I want to talk to every believer here and every believer that's watching. Paul is writing not to conform because it's possible to conform. I think the part of missing out with God in the Old Testament when they were in the wilderness, it said the cloud would move and they would move with the cloud. The only way they could fall behind was refuse to move with what was moving. Oftentimes in our faith, we can be believers, we can be Christian, and God starts to move in a different way, and we lag behind instead of moving with what he's moving with. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. At least we're not moving with a good attitude. Yeah. Hallelujah. Because there's always going to be obstacles. You all look so nice this morning. You all look so good. My, you are a beautiful, handsome bunch of people here today. But if you pulled into the parking lot today and there wasn't a parking space for you, you might have not been conformed to God. You might have not been so transformed. Or you go somewhere and somebody cuts you off in traffic, or something happens in your life, or something happens with one of your kids. Have you conformed to Christ, or are you still the old man? Are you still the person that's not changed yet? And so the only way to know if you've changed, because change is not change until you changed, is the test. Some people tell me they'll never do that again. They'll never do that again in this minute, but sometimes we'll never do what we did because we're not given the same opportunity again. And it's not that you're set free, it's just that you haven't been back in those circumstances again. See, freedom needs to come from the inside to following Christ. And so if I'm going to receive a renewed mind, then I have to say, well, what is the mindset of this world? If I'm not to have the mindset of this world, someone told me that they like to watch the news. And that's good. Like to watch the news maybe 6-8 hours a day. I'm thinking, be not conformed. Where you hang out and what you read and what you look at has the power to conform you. And so if you're looking at the wrong stuff, hanging around with the wrong situations and circumstances, if all of that is happening in your life, it has the power to conform you. And so Jesus is saying here in Romans, be not conformed to this world. That's up to you, what you do. Because you can sit here with a worldly mindset saying, I wonder what God has in store for me. But if you're focused on God and not conformed to the world, the mindset of God will be normal for you. It'll just be natural. So in 3 John 1-4 is where we're going to read this morning. Let's just stand for the reading here. Everybody doing good okay so far?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Now, I want to say John is writing to somebody here, but that name there, Gaius, I could put your name in there, or my name. So I could say, the elder, to my beloved Kevin, whom I love in truth. Yes. To the elder, my beloved Louis, whom I love in truth. It's meant to insert your name when it comes to truth. Because here in this church, we love everybody in truth. You are beloved in truth. So it says here, whom I love in truth. Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health, just as your soul prospers. Everybody we love, we should pray that prayer for. And to know that God's praying that, or in this case, John is praying that for you. For I rejoice greatly when brethren came and testified of the truth that is in you, just as you walk in truth. I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. Father, I pray that the truth that sets us free would have the freedom to touch people in this room today, that we would not leave here like we came. And so for all forces that would oppose truth, I rebuke now in Jesus' name, for every demon in hell, every offset of the enemy that would try to change the agenda in our heart and in our mind, we rebuke that and we focus on letting the mind of Christ be in us, that we would be set free. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. What John was saying to Gaius was, Gaius, the truth I heard about you is that you're treating everybody equally. If you read on a little bit further, this was it. It said you're treating the Christians the right way and you're treating the world the right way. That is a great testimony to say I treat everybody the same. I treat everybody equally. How many could say... Maybe I won't ask you to raise your hand because you might just feel obligated to raise your hand, not in your heart, so no one would do that. But that we treat people differently. I think the great testimony of love is that love always treats everybody equally. Now, we say we love everybody, but yet maybe we haven't been to the institution of learning yet. Because the test of love then will be somebody unloving will contact you. Because we can say with our mouth, I love everybody equally. Well, we'll check that out now. The Holy Spirit will go to work and say, well, let's see if that is true. So here Gaius, John is saying to Gaius, Gaius, I'm so proud of you to walk in the truth. The truth is we should love everybody equally, and you are an example of that truth. And it causes us to understand then that we should walk in truth, and we can say, to my neighbor, to my friends, to my family, I'm going to treat you right, no matter what happens. Like never before in 20, 24. I'll believe for more in 2024. Jesus is Lord in
2024.
You're getting on. So here's the thing, is that divine truth that I want to share can't be based on a carnal opinion. So be very careful in 2024 who you listen to, that it's not just a carnal opinion that they're sharing with you, pretending it to be a divine truth. Because without a renewed mind, you can't share a divine truth because you don't understand. You can't prove what is the will of God. Because if your mind is still on earthly things, you're going to just try to prove you're right and not God. So it's important that like I say for myself, when I stand up here, if my mind's renewed, I have nothing to prove about me. I have nothing to prove about me. Alice read a letter to me that someone wrote and was saying, they've been in the church for 5 years. They came into the church, they had addiction, they had problem, they had anxiety, and that's all gone now. They've been in the church for 5 years, they've been blessed, the Spirit of the Lord has touched them again and again and again. They're totally renewed in this letter, and the date, 1997. And they're still serving God today. The truth is not meant to set you free for a minute, but as long as you keep moving in truth and moving with the cloud and moving with what God is doing, you won't be so upset at an upset that you'll be lost. And we all have upset. I don't expect 2024 to be any different as far as upset goes, because the Holy Spirit's still going to teach us. So with a renewed mind, we can stand up and prove God, and the proof of God is not based on my opinion of God. The proof of seeing your proof of seeing me walking in truth is I'm walking in what I say. Right? If I'm different in my walk than my talk, then I don't have a renewed mind. So when the problem with the exterior of the internet and the exterior of things that we can watch, we have no idea who we're watching, whether they're walking. We're only watching what they're at that minute. And so, but without a renewed mind, they are going to be more interested in proving that they are right than God is right. The proof you need in being a believer is not what you hear, it's how you walk. Because we can all hear a different thing. So Jesus was God's proof, and Jesus was declaring that God was true. Does our word and does our walk prove that God is true? And that's what I feel for 2024, that we need to prove to the world that we believe in God by our walk. By this renewed mind that we're supposed to have, that Adam was saying about feeling convicted and looking for an answer. If this world is convicted, they're going to look for an answer from you. And are you going to have a walk before them that they're going to come to you? Hallelujah.
Amen.
See, God does not need to prove that I'm real. I need to prove to the world that God's real. Because it's the world that's supposed to see our good works and glorify the Father, which is in heaven. Yeah. Those that saw Jesus, Jesus said, well, you're seeing the Father. I am absolutely convinced, according to the Word, that whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord can be saved.
Amen.
Regardless of what you've done. I've heard people give me reasons why they felt that God wouldn't save them. I said, well, no, that's impossible. You're basing what God won't do on you. I'm basing what God will do on Jesus.
Amen.
He said already he would forgive you if you would ask. So the truth, the renewed mind. So if somebody said, and I've heard this said, well, this person was a child molester. Oh, well, they're going to go to hell. That's it. They're all done. And as if that sin was somehow so much greater on the cross that Jesus couldn't quite cover that one, but all of your sin he seemed to take care of. It's either all sin or no sin or some sin. If it's some sin to you, your mind's not renewed. Because with a renewed mind, it's not the degree of sin that sends a sinner to hell. It's the lack of salvation in Christ Jesus that condemns all mankind. And with a renewed mind, you understand that instead of giving your earthly opinion or your carnal opinion of God. And no wonder the world is confused about what God will do. And we can sing, it is no secret what I will believe if I condemn you. Don't be deceived. Hallelujah. With arms wide open, hell will receive you. I don't know. I do know that Jesus had no trouble in drawing sinners to himself. It seems the church is having a hard time to draw the same sinful world. And the gap is not in God. The gap is in the renewed mind that we need to see the world as potentially saved. John was saying to his beloved Gaius, because he was treating everybody equally, he said, I just rejoice. My heart greatly rejoices that that guy's walking in the truth. Adam's testimony this morning, I was over here greatly rejoicing in Adam walking in the truth. It's not that he's not going to have any more problems or have any less problems, but he has learned something about truth. The truth, or the ability to let go of past hurts, is a powerful lesson in how to hold on to the hand of God into future success. If you, in order to treat everybody equally, first of all, you got to get your head straightened around that past mistakes. See, I think for Gaius, he probably had past mistakes. We all have past mistakes. Anybody here never had any problems ever in your life? And somehow we believe that God has totally forgiven us. See, the renewed mind is what can prove God. But unrenewed mind is going to say, well, you know, my past problems he can take care of. The very fact that you say that means that a past problem is still bothering you. Because if a past problem, if all your past problems were totally forgiven and you were set free of that, you wouldn't have the mindset to judge other people. Hallelujah. Lord, it's getting quiet in here today. Last Sunday was so noisy and loud. Same preacher, same pulpit. Mostly the same crowd. Same truth, same word, new year. Come on, somebody.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I want to make this statement, and I'll explain this statement, as you will notice in a second here. What you believe to be real, you think to be true. What you believe to be real, you think to be true. But I have discovered that my real and his truth can be two different things. My real is only real to me. His truth covers everybody.
Amen.
And if I don't open my mind up to his truth, I can't cover you.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. See, okay, here. An atheist being real doesn't believe in God. Shake your head even. Just give me a wink. If you want to say amen, just say, Pastor, I hear you. I'm not allowed to say amen today. It's a new year. I said I'm not going to talk in church anymore. So, an atheist being real doesn't believe in God.
Amen.
But his real is not true.
That's right. Amen.
So just because you say, well, I want to keep it real, doesn't mean you want to keep it true.
Amen.
See, keeping it true may cost you something. Keeping it true means I can't get angry. Keeping it true means I got to love you no matter what. Keeping it true. See, the truth will set you free. See, Jesus, keeping it true, died on the cross for you. He could have called 12 legions of angels. He could have done, got himself away from there. We have far less problems than we try to escape. Instead of, oh, well, we want to keep it real. No, you don't. You just want to keep it that you're not guilty. And so God's truth, the Holy Spirit, the professor of God, which is the Holy Spirit, wants to lead us into all truth. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. So there is no other way but Jesus. There's no other truth than his truth. Amen. The way, the truth, and the life. There's really no other life to live than the life you live as a believer. Amen. And so I want to bring in an Old Testament character here for you. See what we're doing in time. Well, we're doing good. We're almost out of it. Naaman was a Syrian general. He was a great leader, but he had a problem. He was a leper. He was from Syria, a leper. He captured a girl in Israel. She was a slave girl in his house. And the girl said, too bad Naaman wasn't over in Israel. The prophet of the Lord would heal him. Well, he wanted to be healed. So 2 Kings chapter 5, verse 9, it says, then Naaman went with his horses and chariot, and he stood at the door of Elijah's house. And Elijah sent a messenger to him, saying, go, wash in the Jordan 7 times, and your flesh shall be restored to you, and you shall be clean. But Naaman became furious and went away and said, indeed, I said to myself, he will surely come out to me and stand and gaze at my wonder and call on the name of the Lord his God and just simply wave his hand over the place, over that spot, and heal my leprosy. It's wonderful when you have a God that plans, God's got to obey your plan. And if he doesn't, you become furious. Oh, I thought the church would be like this. It's not like this. I'm never going again. It'd be great if you did that at Superstore or Sobeys or someplace. They'd see you there next week. See, you can't quit something that's essential to giving you life, like food. You can't quit God when it becomes essential that his food feeds you.
Amen.
So Naaman was in the right place at the right time, and he received the right word, a word that he could easily do, but he was confronted with his own flesh. Verse 11, he said, indeed, I said to myself, that's a killer right there. Indeed, I said to myself, I am a general. I am the CEO. I can say, I am the pastor. You have to. Anytime we do that, we have moved ourselves from the thinking of God to the carnal thinking of man, where man honor man according to title, where God treats us all equally. And without a renewed mind, your position can be detrimental to your health. And any time we try to carry the weight of God by telling God how to do it, we will become depressed in the carrying of something we were never created to carry. You were never created to be God. You were never created to counsel God. And so God could have done this Naaman's way. God could have said, this is what Naaman wants, because God knows your heart. So God could have said to Elijah, just go out, stand over him, wave your hand over the spot, and all will be good. So why would the prophet get a different word than what the person wanted? See, I think he was a general, but he was private. Military people will catch this. He was a general, but he was private concerning his problem. How many people are private concerning your problem? Just smile. You don't need to. Yeah. You can be a general. Oh, I'm the pastor, the man of faith and power. not fluff and flour. He doesn't have any problems. So if I show a weakness or a problem, you may not like me anymore. So the general was this man who I think when he had his armor on, he probably had a double armor on where the leprosy was, because he didn't want anybody to know. How much do you cover up where you're hurting and you don't want anybody to know about it? And Pastor, just wave your hand over our marriage. It'll be all right. Just wave your hand over my anger issue, Lord. It'll be all right. So Pastor, just do this for me, because I don't want anybody to know that I got a problem. And that was this Syrian general here. He didn't want anybody to know. And the answer was, go down to the river. Now, how many know if you got armor on, not a good place to get in the river? You drowned. He knew he was going to have to take the armor off. If I take the armor off, people are going to see that I got a problem. No. Just have the prophet come out, wave his hand. See, he wasn't covered in leprosy. It wasn't like everybody knew. It wasn't like it was just a fact you seen him. Well, he's a leper. He kept it hidden because he said, why wouldn't he just come out and wave his hand over the spot? It's only a little issue I have with anger. It's only a little issue I have with jealousy. It's only a little issue I hate. I only hate certain people. I don't hate everybody. I just, this little problem. Maybe you just wave your hand over the spot. And yet in the school of the Holy Spirit, and see, I believe that God would have done it Naaman's way if that was the only problem that Naaman had. The bigger issue was not the leprosy. The bigger issue was his pride. And sometimes we go through things with our issue thinking, well, God, why don't you fix my issue? The issue is not the issue. Your bigger issue is how you respond to God. How that you feel that you can treat anybody any way at all. And Naaman as a general felt, well, I'll just put this armor on and nobody will know. Like Adam in the garden, let's put the fig leaves on so nobody will know. Nobody will notice. Put on this and put on a coat. Fix my hair. I seen two little girls come in today and they had those braids in their hairs. Femi's kids, they had the braids all down. I said, boy, that's beautiful. I said, do you want to do Louie's hair like that? One of them reached up to go. Now that's faith in action right there, to believe. Nothing is impossible with God. But we have this thing where if we can do it the easiest, simplest way without anybody knowing about it, and yet God says to cast our cares upon him, for he cares for us. It's the confession of your faith. It's the confession to believe in your heart and confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus Christ. It would be nice if we could just say, well, everybody's saved. Everybody's saved. Oh, well, I did it. No, don't worry about that. We don't want to expose you ever did anything wrong in your life. We don't want to mention sin. We don't want to mention what's going on in sin. But no, if we just say there's no such thing as sin, it's going to sound a lot better. It can be real. It just can't be truth. See, those that are really saved are walking in the real truth that salvation is possible. And we expose that to the world. In Matthew, Jesus said, the greatest among you shall be your servant, and whoever exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. The healing was a small thing. The weightier thing was what God was after. When we get saved, it can seem it's a wonderful world until God, the Holy Spirit, shows up as our teacher and expects us to learn according to his word. Another sentence I wrote down for you. When we try to function in the divine according to the flesh, we are dysfunctional before God. When we try to function in the divine according to the flesh, we are dysfunctional before God. Naaman needed a healing, but he also needed to tell God how to do it. Have you ever advised God? I think we all have. I think we can all the honest, renewed mind people will say, yep, tried many times. You can say the statement about church. How can you attend church and worship and go home and sin? I don't know if you ever heard that or not. How can you attend church and worship and go home and sin? I said, how can you attend church and worship and not go home and sin? Are you so perfect in your own mind that you think that you're going to go home this week and not sin? You do not have a renewed mind. Because only a carnal person would think somebody else is going home and sinning, but I'm not. We've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Without a renewed mind, you can look around a room and condemn people when really you should be looking at your unrenewed mind, your carnal thinking, and saying, why am I thinking that way? I can't go home and live all week and not sin. Why would I say that you are a problem to come to church and worship and go home and not sin? Hallelujah. I might have to wear a path out around this pulpit today. I can see. Sometimes Alice will say to me, no, it's not that they didn't hear you. It's that they were thinking.
Amen.
Amen. Sometimes by notifying me that you're thinking with an amen, that's just helpful. How many amens do I have over here?
Amen. Yeah,
just put them just a second now. How many hallelujahs?
Put
them in there we go. Now if I need one, I'll just pull one out. Hallelujah. I don't expect 2024 to be a sinless situation, a sinless world. I do expect myself to try my best to live for God with a renewed mind. I am asking God for a great harvest in 2024. I am asking people, I'm asking God to help people have a renewed mind. I pray anxiety comes from a false sense or false expectation. I pray that anxiety would leave this church this year, that no one would feel the consequence of anxiety through a disappointment. I pray that, Lord, that this church would be a place that people will come to be encouraged. And I pray that sickness and disease would have to flee from this place because, God, you show up here. Lord, I believe that those that, and I'm going to address young people now, the young people that are confused and wondering, you know, what's life all about, that this year they will find a foundation in God that will establish them for the years to come. And they will be strong in the Lord and in the power of the might. I declare this, I decree this in Jesus' name. I pray for the congregation of this church that we would continue to flourish in the mind of God. That, Lord, we would understand you and your ways like never before. And, Lord, not only would we be transformed, but our families, the extended family, and this community would feel the effect of a people that have their mind set on God. Lord, I pray this in Jesus' name.
Amen.
I pray that as I was thinking about this year, and I was saying, God, it's a year of another garden. This was my closing remark here. I didn't get an amen even on a closing remark. I better pull it. Hallelujah. Yeah, there we go. The garden. I thought about the garden that I have in my yard there. I thought those are the people who have a garden. This year I'll have to till the ground if I want anything. I'll have to plant seed. I'll have to weed the seed, and at times I'll even have to water it. But the main ingredient for my garden is the sunlight. And unless the sun shines on my garden, all my labor's in vain. Because the main ingredient for cause a garden to grow is not me. It's the sun. The main ingredient in the church is the Son of God,
amen,
who is the light of the world,
amen,
to cause his people to grow.
Amen.
And may his sun shine on all of us,
amen,
this year.
Good,
and cause us to grow in all things that we plant, that this year would be a great year of harvest for us and our home. I pray this. If you receive that, just raise your hand to receive that. I just receive. Lord, I believe that you will shine on our garden, in our home, and cause it to be transformed with a harvest like we've never seen before. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, hallelujah. We have communion here for you. We're going to ask our servers to pass that out. I'll ask Josh to come back on the keyboard for me. Hallelujah. If you're visiting today, you're welcome to share in the communion. Thank you. If you're here today and you don't know Jesus as your Savior, it's a matter of asking Him to forgive you, but He is already speaking to your heart about that. And if that's you today, we can pray for you that you would accept Jesus into your heart. It is a sense that, for Adam said earlier, he said it just felt convicted on the inside that he needed to change. He felt convicted on the inside about God. With his carnal mind, he read the Bible and had nightmares. With his saved mind, he now dreams dreams and casts visions. There's a big difference between saved and unsaved, reading the Bible. If that's you today and you'd like to accept Jesus as your Savior, just raise your hand up and pray for you today that you would accept Jesus as your Savior. Yes, thank you for that hand. Thank you. Someone else? Anywhere else? Yes, thank you. Anywhere else? Hallelujah. Father, I pray for those that have asked Jesus, the Son of God, to shine in their life. That, Lord, the renewal of this year would start with a renewal in their heart. That, Lord, it's a new day. It's a new day. A day to rejoice and be glad in God. I pray that the riches of salvation would flood their heart and fill them, Lord, to overflowing. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Sometimes as I'm up here, I sense different things that's in the hearts of people. And for all the students that are here, the CBC, the U on the end of it, CBU, that institution of learning, it can seem that It can seem at times discouraging to have such great hopes, to find there's great hardship in making transition. It's one thing to say, I'll leave my family and my home and it'll all be great where I'm going. It's another thing to run into obstacles and problems and have missing your heart. So Lord, I pray this morning, Lord, for every student that has made a transition and yet feels the frustration and even the desperation of need and comfort and peace, that, Lord, that they would find that here in the kingdom of God. That, Lord, that you would restore unto them abundantly the joy of your salvation towards them. And that, Lord, that you called them on purpose for a purpose. And, Lord, may they find their destiny and their divine order and follow what the Lord has asked them to do. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Let's stand together for the communion. The Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, he broke it, he blessed it, he gave thanks for it. He gave it to his disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body, which was broken for you. Father, I thank you today for the broken. The broken can be mended now. Anyone here that feels broken, he was broken for you, that you might be made well. So Lord, I thank you for that all the areas of all our brokenness, we now can partake in something that makes us whole again. In Jesus' name, amen. And after the supper was ended, he took the cup and he said, this cup is a new covenant in my blood. As often as you do eat the bread, drink the cup, you proclaim. That's what I was trying to say to us this morning, is that we're all proclaimers in our lifestyle to the world around us. He was proclaiming that this is a new covenant, and he proved it in his blood. Lord, may we walk in the evidence of salvation, that the world around us can't deny that we're saved, born again by the Spirit of God. We thank you for the price that you paid. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. Greet your neighbor and say, very nice to see you in church today. Yeah.